The fourth body of evidence is actually the most powerful. It is the newest and the most exciting to many evolutionary biologists, and this is the biochemical evidence. Biochemical evidence rests on our ability now to sequence the DNA in every animal that lives on Earth. We have this long chain of DNA, and as we'll see, beginning in the next lecture, the precise sequence of nucleotides in these base pairs along this DNA molecule are like a library of information and a library of evolutionary history. We can take similarities and differences in these DNA sequences and use that like a molecular clock, which assumes a constant rate of mutation in each specific region of the DNA. If we look at long regions of DNA, sequence the base pairs, and we compare the number of differences, these are called nucleotide substitutions along a strand of the DNA, it turns out that species that we had good reason to say had separated a long, long period of time ago have many more of those nucleotide substitutions than species that we reckon have only recently diverged from each other. And this is such an apparently linear relationship that we can actually go anywhere along this line and say, well, if there's this many substitutions, it must have happened this many millions of years ago. Okay? Now, it turns out that we have to be careful when we make these estimates of the time span of diversification, because some regions of the DNA are known to mutate more rapidly than others. But once you've found that this is a slowly evolving region, it does seem to have a fairly constant rate of evolution in different species. And so we can use these slowly evolving regions to look at differences between very distantly related organisms. And we'll see examples of this later in the course. Now, here's a case where they've used DNA to look to see when different groups of fish must have diversified from each other. This is a very interesting group of fish called coelacanths. Those that are alive on Earth today are considered a living fossil. There are other fishes that have diversified more recently. And the evidence that were available based on fossil record, morphological change, that is physical changes, line up incredibly closely with the DNA over a time scale, so that we can say that some of these changes must have happened between 400 and 500 million years ago, others only happened about 50 million years ago. So this gives us an anchor, and I've shown you plenty of trees by now, but this is what was done, was to look at the number of DNA substitutions that you can have as a clock to convert genetic change into a time scale. And this is something we'll see towards the end of the course that's an amazing thing that reconciles the differences across the major groups of animals. You have starfish, acorn worms, earthworms, clams, ribbon worms, insects, etc., etc. These are all the living groups of animals on Earth, going all the way back to really simple things like sponges. Okay? And using those slowly evolving regions of DNA, it's possible to give a date for when they diversified. And the timing of this, relatively speaking, that the starfish and the acorn worms would have separated more recently than these echinoderms did with other groups over here, is very consistent between the DNA and all the other measures we have. And this is fantastic because these things, these soft body parts, sponges don't fossilize very well, sea anemones, sea fish, jellyfish, they don't fossilize very well, and there's not a good fossil record through these regions. But the DNA is consistent with a picture that had been developed of when they relatively should have happened. Now we have an absolute timescale, and the absolute timescale actually makes sense from what we know about the geology and other periods of time when the fossil record was much better back in the about 650 million years ago, as opposed to this region through here and some of these regions in here where there's not much fossils at all. Now, why do we care? And that's the absolute intellectual joy of making order. I mean, Linnaeus was trying to understand the mind of the Creator. Others are trying to reconstruct evolutionary history. And there's a lot of people who really are fascinated inherently with these questions of what the genetic relationships, the evolutionary relationships may be between different groups. But it's also the case that understanding phylogeny can have a very important applied consequence. And I want to do this with bacteria. Bacteria are the source of an awful lot of disease in our lives. And if you just look at bacteria under a microscope, there are only a few things that you can obviously tell. And I don't know if you've ever heard of the term of a gram negative or a gram positive. These things have different numbers of cell walls. And so these were used roughly to classify bacteria. But with the advent of molecular techniques, looking at the DNA that is the genetics of each one of these microorganisms, we can have a more precise evolutionary tree, and we can look at related species of bacteria, and this has a really important applied consequence. So if we want to treat infections from a certain kind of bacterial parasite, if we know its relationship to other, perhaps better studied or better controlled bacteria, then we'll have a head start in trying to develop a cure. So for example, down here, these branch of bacteria are called actinobacteria. And actinobacteria cause tuberculosis, nasty disease of the lungs, versus leprosy, which is a nasty disease that makes your fingers and toes go numb, so they fall off eventually. But the same drug, however you pronounce that, is a good treatment for both, and it works because they're so closely related. Up here, in this branch of the bacteria, there are the spirochetes, okay? And these are two very different diseases, Lyme disease, which is spread by tick bites, and syphilis, a sexually transmitted disease. But because they're so closely related, penicillin works perfectly well to treat people who are infected with either bacteria. Up here we have chlamydia, another sexually transmitted disease, and hey, doxycycline works really well in chlamydia. If we go a little bit further up here, we have these alpha proteobacteria. We look at them in more detail. Here's a couple of diseases, rickettsia, nasty bacterial infection, and anaplasmosis, which is a kind of walking pneumonia. Because they're so closely related and they're not that far even from the chlamydia, doxycycline works on all of them. So knowing these phylogenies does have practical applications. So we can even do this in terms of forensic science. You may have seen CSI where people will take a genetic sample and they'll say, oh, okay, you know, DNA fingerprints tells us this was the guy, this was the rapist or whoever. But we can also take advantage of the fact that even viruses evolve in order to solve some fairly complicated mysteries. In the 1980s, a dangerous new disease started infecting people all over the world, and that was HIV, the human immunodeficiency virus. And at that time, most of the victims of HIV were either male homosexuals or drug addicts, intravenous drug users. But there was a cluster of cases of HIV in Florida that appeared in 1990. And none of these victims fit the usual profile of an HIV case. They were all heterosexual, and none of them were IV drug users. So how are they getting this disease? In order to address this problem, microbiologists took samples from each victim, extracted the virus, and sequenced it. And once they sequenced the DNA in each one of these viruses, they were able to find a pattern. It turns out that all the victims had very similar strains of HIV. Other people with HIV from Florida, the strains that they were carrying were not nearly as similar as all of these in this atypical batch. Okay? And what's really key is it turns out that they all had a strain very similar to a particular dentist who's identified here as Dentist X. So he had a series of patients. There's patient B, patient A, patient E. And the HIV virus they had was very similar to that in Dentist X. Okay? Here's another patient G, patient C, again, similar to Dentist X. And even another dentist here, Dentist Y, has a different strain. Okay? Now, how could that be? So, all these atypical cases were patients of the same dentist. Well, it turned out that this dentist was a real psychopath. Once he realized he had HIV, he was enormously angry, and he lashed out against the world and existence by deliberately infecting his patients. So, we look at evolution as a profoundly important organizing principle in all of biology. The evidence is overwhelming. More and more people are finding true transitional fossils, like that otter with the head of a seal, Archaeopteryx, a bird with teeth. We're finding homologies everywhere. We have whales with pelvises, snakes with vestigial legs, even humans with a vestigial tail. When we line up all these different forms of evidence, from geology with their absolute geochronology, we can construct a DNA chronology that makes sense. Everything triangulates. In popular usage, people often refer to the theory of evolution, and that somehow diminishes in the popular understanding the true power of this concept. In science, theory means an analytic structure designed to explain a set of empirical observations. A scientific theory identifies a set of empirical observations as a class of phenomena, and the class of phenomena we're interested in is similarities between species. It makes assertions about the underlying reality that brings about or affects those phenomena. What is it that we need to have had happen so that we would have a whale from a hippo, that we would have a chicken that's still capable of growing teeth? The assertions we make are evolutionary theory. Just like the theory of relativity, the theory of gravity, there is a theory of evolution that explains a broad variety of phenomena. It's the most powerful idea in biology and is the true organizing principle of everything we discuss in this course. In biology, evolution explains the origins, maintenance, and relationships of all living things.